who became a spontaneous leaker, and then through numerous surgeries ended up, I think, with the final fix in 2013, and lived with some high pressure problems till 2015, until she finally felt well. But it's kind of a comical story, and we're going to do a little Hollywood here today. So, any of you remember this movie?
Oh, yeah.
Yeah. Well, I'll tell you, if you really remembered, what did John Candy do for a living? You remember? He sold the plastic rings that held up shower curtains. That was it. You remember that? And, of course, it was an exaggeration of what it's like to travel, but if you've ever traveled with children or family, vacations always rank high in stress. Our traveling was complicated. We lived in Ohio, Canton, Ohio, and we had to get to Dr. Shavink here in L.A. And when she was first diagnosed in 2000, we had trouble getting a diagnosis, and we ran all around the country. And she was not feeling well, but flying seemed to make her worse, but she tolerated it. In 2001, when she first went to see Dr. Shavink, she flew out there and just got so sick that the airplane people wanted to put her off in Kansas City, which of course wasn't going to do her much good. And I was to come later. I was working, and if she was going to need something invasive, I was going to come. Well, she couldn't tolerate the flight, but they took her on to L.A. When she landed in L.A., the EMS people wanted to take her to Orange County, which, of course, was not where she could get treatment, so she had to convince them to take her to Cedars-Sinai, where she got treatment, eventually had surgery in 2001, and got a pretty good result. She had a ventral leak in the T6-7 area, and it seemed like we were cured. Back in those days, there was no talk about high pressure headaches, and she was experiencing some high pressure headaches, didn't know whether she was really re-leaking. So she stayed with a cousin in Carlsbad, California for a couple of weeks, was readmitted to Cedars. They reevaluated her, were pretty sure she wasn't leaking, but didn't know why she was symptomatic. That being said, she was afraid to fly home. So my son was flown from Ohio to California, and they took the train to Cleveland. Any of you ridden trains lately? They're not the most comfortable things in the world. They may be in Canada, but they sure aren't in the United States, so that was a bit of a torture chamber for her. But she got there, so for about 5 years, she was asymptomatic. 2006, she got symptomatic again, and we had to go come back out here. So we determined that we had to drive. So now, some of you ladies are not lucky enough to be married to a husband who rarely needs advice and never needs directions, but my wife is lucky enough to be married to such a person. So I got the brilliant idea that I would rent this 28-foot camper, which I thought was perfect. She could lie down and I could drive, and we didn't know how long it was going to take us to get here. When we made this trip in the future, we had it kind of 500-mile blocks because it was about as long as she could go in a day, and I could have done it in one day, but it was, you know, 2,500 miles, that was nothing, you know. So we'd go to St. Louis, to Oklahoma City, to Amarillo, to Albuquerque, to places like Flagstaff, and then on. Well, if you've ever ridden in one of these, and I think they may be better now, it's like being in a buckboard or a trampoline. So there was no way she could lie down in this thing. I mean, it was kaboom, kaboom, kaboom. She looked like she was on springs, so I was just killing her. We got to Flagstaff, Arizona, and headed south to Phoenix to go to a resort so she could rest up a couple days. We had allowed time, and anybody here from Phoenix? Okay, there's the Phoenix group. We went to the Gainey Ranch, and if she would understand what a nice kind of a posh resort that is, so she could have a couple of days of rest and maybe go to the spa or whatever. And I pulled up in the Gainey Ranch in this. I hadn't thought much about it, but the bellman went apoplectic. before I could get out of the doggone vehicle, he was at my side. You can't park this here. You can't park this here. Well, I'm not parking it here. I'm just trying to get my wife out. She needs to lie down, and I need to get the luggage out. I leave the keys in it. You know, you can valet it and park. I don't want to drive it. You can't park it here. You can't park it here. So we go round and round. I finally said, look, my wife's going in. I'll come and move it. Move it now. Well, they had about five or six of these beautiful Italian sport cars lined up along the side. They don't park them in the parking lot. There's two reasons for that. One, the show factor for the hotel. And the other is the people who pay that much money for a car don't want their doors dinged. So by this time, I was sort of passive aggressive. So I pulled the camper up and parked it in front of all of those, left the keys in it, and went in. So we stayed there for a couple of days and went on. Now, have you ever tried to double park a camper in LA? The Gainey Ranch is wide open, but our hotel, it wouldn't fit underneath. It wouldn't fit through the parking gate. And we were lucky enough that there was a place where they used buses to come into the hotel we were staying in. We could put it in there for a while. Now, we had to go and have testing done, so I had to leave it there, and we'd take a cab over to Cedars-Sinai. And the manager would have to run out when the bus came and try to move the camper. It became apparent that this wouldn't work because she was going to need more surgery, and they were going to have time, so I flew my son from Tampa, Florida to Ohio, my son from Charleston, South Carolina to Ohio, both of them from Ohio to Southern California, to LA, and they drove the camper back. So they had to go to Ohio because that's where the camper had to be dropped off. So that took care of that one. And she was well enough after a few weeks to feel like she could fly home. We were starting to understand that when she had high pressure, she could fly. When she had low pressure, she couldn't. So we got back home, and by 2008, she was becoming symptomatic again. So we knew we were going to have to go back out. So I bought this vehicle, which was a good idea. Maybe the better, not needing advice, I made a good choice this time. And it could lay all the seats down in the back in there and put lots of foam, and she could lie back there and got a wedge, and she could float along in this thing. And this vehicle was made to cruise, and it was really, really well designed. And we came cross country in that, I think, four times and back. And it was really a what did you name this car, Tanny?
Mercy.
Mercy. So we you know, came back and forth in Mercy. So 2011 and 2013, again, we had to come back out and have additional surgery. Now, in 2011, we got to Albuquerque, New Mexico, and a chip went out in the car. So it was like on a Friday, we had to get towed, and we stayed in a hotel, and we had a clinic appointment on Monday that we had to make so that if she was going to have surgery, she could have it on Tuesday. Well, of course, if you go to a dealer in Albuquerque, New Mexico, they don't have this part. So we had to wait, go to the hotel, and found out that we had to take the overnight train on Saturday to Sunday to LA and leave the car there. So we left the car there. This surgery, talking to the guy back and forth, they were having lots of trouble for some reason getting this little chip. So the long and short of that, she got a fix again and went back, and we flew back, and I had to flatbed my car from Albuquerque, New Mexico to Canton, Ohio, so that I could get it fixed back there. So this is the leak that she had. You might have seen this on the website. She had a ventral leak. And in 2013, they were finally able to have the technology where they could torque her spine in the T7, T8 area and actually visualize this and sew it and patch it. She wasn't immediately well, but she had high pressure problems, and we were able to get back home. In 2014, she had minor symptoms. We had to come back out, and stay, and then the stay got extended as she got, when she, they did a lumbar patch, and that made her high pressure headaches worse. I had to fly my oldest son's significant other out. Well, he spent 2 weeks with her, fly back home to Ohio and work. When you do surgery, if you don't work, you don't get paid. So that was flying her then back to Canton with Tanny, and then her back to South Carolina where she lived a couple weeks later. So it was been, if you'd seen Plane, Trains, and Automobile, it might have been written about us. And it took till 2015 till she really fell normal. It took a year and a half, I think, after her final 2013 treatment for her to feel well. And she still feels well from leaking. Anybody see this movie?
Yeah.
Yes, just a few people? Yeah. Do you know, do you remember what it was about? It was about a loss of a daughter, and Will Smith's grief over that daughter. And it really was a poignant movie. It his grief consumed him. He was unable to do anything. He almost lost his job. He almost lost his company. He didn't care if he lived. He was just totally grief-stricken in this. And dealing with grief, when you have somebody that's chronically ill, is a problem in a sense that you really do grieve. I don't think we ever went through all the classic stages of grief. I don't think we ever got quite to acceptance. Somehow or another, we always thought that she was going to get well, so that was good. But one of the things you learn about grief is this stuff called asynchronous grief. And if some of you are caregivers or you're a spouse of somebody who leaks, you've experienced this. And basically, it comes down to that you don't grieve at the same time in the same way. And somebody may be down and somebody's not down. And the person who's down can't understand why the person who isn't down isn't down. And so you misconnect. They feel like they're alone. They feel like you're not really connecting at all because you're just out of sync. We experience this on another level I call asynchronous communication. When doing surgery, you're either inflicting pain or hearing about people who are in pain. So after a long day of talking to people in pain, I would come home and be out of words. You know, men only get 8,000 words a day. And my 8,000 were long gone. And she had been isolated at home, lying down and not being able to do much and want to talk. And those things make for conflict that you don't expect. But it is a reality. So there's asynchronous grief and asynchronous communication that you have to realize happens and then try to make accommodation in both ways. Now, what happens because of all this? I think I'll do these from the bottom up. You become, as I used to say, you're like you moved, but you're still in your same home. The people that you did things with continue to do those things, and after a while they stop asking you to do them because you can't plan and you can't do them. And over time you feel isolated. If you used to go play cards, you don't play cards. If you used to go to parties, you don't go to parties. And it's hard to plan anything because if you plan anything with somebody and you don't feel well, you don't go. So after a while, you feel more and more isolated as the world goes by and you're not participating. The financial part of this varies from person to person. There are people that live in other countries who can't get care, that can't get treatment. As you could imagine, going back and forth, staying in motels, staying in restaurants and whatever is not an inexpensive proposition. Trying to arrange transportation, all the things that cost money aside from deductibles and pharmaceuticals, all add up. It's a very expensive proposition to get care, and it's not to be underestimated. Now, personal and professional, the decade of our 60s was going to be our travel decade. We didn't at that time have a suitcase full of pills. We were supposed to be in relatively good health. The kids were supposed to have been gone and on their way. My practice was mature, and I could actually afford to travel, but you couldn't plan travel. So we would plan something, then not be able to go, and after a while, you don't plan. A lot of vacation time for me is eaten up in going back and forth from California. So it's just the financial implications don't have to do just directly with medical care. There are other things that occur. Now, these last two, personal and professional, has to do with the caregivers. If you are a ball fan of some kind and your team has a close game and loses, you will sit there as the quarterback or whatever and say, you know, I should have been there. I would have done this, and the result would have been we'd have won, and the confetti would have come down, and everybody would have carried me off the field on their shoulders. So personally, I was sure that when I got to that age in my life that I was going to join the senior golf tour and make millions of dollars. Now, I rarely break 90, but all I needed was time, you know. So I was counting on getting that time, and I was going to hone my skills in Scotland and come back and just tear it up. Professionally, you know, I was going to be the governor of Ohio, although I never ran for elected office. But the point of that is you cannot let your mind run away from you and imagine what it would have been like if this didn't happen. You do yourself a great disservice, and it's a fool's journey. But I hear that all the time. I had occasion through these, have spouses call me and say, well, I can't do this, and I would have been able to do this. And it's simply something you can't let your mind do. You learn that life isn't about avoiding pain. You learn that life is about dealing with pain. Everybody has pain and problems and disappointments in life. And you know, it'd be nice if you could avoid it, but you just can't. Now, do you remember this movie? Most people know this movie. Was it a wonderful life? No. The star of this show, George Bailey, when it starts, is trying to commit suicide. He was going to be an architect and build buildings and build bridges and never got to do that. He was going to travel and see the world and have a sticker on his suitcase for every place he went, and he never got to do that. He was never going to take over his dad's building alone, but that's what he had to do. He wasn't going to get married, but he did. I mean, everything that he wanted to do in life, he never really got to do. So why was it a wonderful life? It was a wonderful life in reflection. When he looked back, he could see that it was a wonderful life. So sometimes in pain and sometimes in difficulty, it's really hard to tell that you might have a wonderful life. And, you know, when you're in the midst of that, it's not wonderful. If you've been to a wedding in the last 10 years, somewhere along the line, they read these words, you know, from Corinthians 13:13, that these three remain: faith, hope, and love. But of course, the emphasis is on love because you're getting married. And the other two seem to just fade in the communication. But I think that's a mistake. Faith, of course, gives you a spiritual connection to something bigger than yourself. And it helps you to have that perspective as you go through difficulty. I'm not saying you have to believe in God. My wife and I do, but you don't have to. But everybody has a spiritual side that they need to relate to that gets bigger than themselves and gets them outside of themselves. So this relates you to something bigger than yourself, and it's very important. Hope. Anybody think hope's not important? Well, hope is a little different. It doesn't relate you to something bigger than yourself, it relates you to yourself. My wife is a color pencil artist. So two different kinds. This is a black and white of her mother from a photograph. And this is our backyard in the spring. One just one way, one another way. You learn that you don't make colors with just a pencil and colored pencil. If you want yellow, you might use a layer of blue, layer of red, layer of pink, before you finally pick up the yellow pencil to get the shade you want. Now, and same with this, it's not black and white, it's shades of gray. Uh-oh. I'm sure none of you saw that movie. But in case, but in case you did, the foundation is now selling purple cufflinks outside as you leave. So even when she was well, she would go and work on these a little bit, and you would see progress, and progress meant hope. It might take her 9 months to do a 1 month project, but she plugged away. Connie talked about the mind, hand, mind, body connection. This was her mind, body connection. This is a different story. How many of you have pets? Okay, well, pets teach you a lot about living and they teach you a lot about dying. This shepherd mix lived for 17 years. He was this down here, only person he cuddled with, only. If he was in that position, Tanny went to the bathroom, he would follow her. So it was a really, he only needed one person in the world, and she was it. If this dog could have earned a paycheck, I'd have been homeless. So those three things, faith, hope, love, provide purpose and meaning to life, and they work synergistically. So if you're feeling particularly hopeless, faith and love pick you up. If your husband comes home and doesn't talk to you and you don't feel loved, then you have faith and you have hope to help you. So they don't work in isolation, and it's a complete circle. And when you can manage that, you can manage the pain and the difficulty that you go through. Anybody know who this is? Garth Brooks, right. I once heard country music described as four chords and the truth.
Looking back love.
Tanny just completed 6 months of chemotherapy. Excuse me. But she navigated that.
I'm Tanny, and that's my husband, and that's kind of what it's been like for a long time. I want to say that there have been some very important people in all of this, and I just feel as if I need to mention their names. Michaels would be first. And I want to mention Dr. Shivank, and I want to mention Connie DeLine, and my dog's name was Kiro. But I've had such good support from those beloved people, and Dr. Shivank's techniques changed some through the years. I had 5 surgeries. But really what was done to me fifth time around could not have been done third time around because of learning, because of new imaging, and just evolvement. And I just feel so blessed that he didn't look at me after the second time and say, you know, I don't want to see you again, or I can't do any more for you. And that he was willing to grow with me and keep taking me back, so to speak. When I was sick, I was very sick and just disabled. So, and Connie, I met Connie in the waiting room of Dr. Shivank's office. Was it 2007, Connie, or 1? I just could watch her body language and know that she had what I had. And so I approached her and said, are you leaking spinal fluid? She looked at me and she said, is that written all over my face? And I could have said, yes, it is written all over your face to someone who understands. So, but just the knowledge and the sharing and the just the support, I understand those 2 words. So I've been blessed by that, healed by that. And I would encourage all of you, do not give up on it. It's just often not a straight line. It's just such a changing journey. And the lymphoma that I have had, and that my scans are clear now. I don't know where that exactly is going either, but that was a curve I wasn't expecting. I was constantly, I'm real good at knowing when my head isn't quite right, or when I feel peculiar pain between my shoulder blades, or I get up and the room's going around a little bit, and I think, ye gods, this time to do something. But this I wasn't looking for, and I ignored some things that I should not have ignored. So I would, don't do that. Don't do that. The body is still, you know, you're still subject to all of these things that anyone is subject to. And so stay in touch with it in other ways other than just that. That just becomes so dominating that that's kind of the way your mind works. And Michael also wanted me to compare the 2 ailments, just so those of you who are sitting here who do not leak or have not experienced it lit firsthand. I went through quite a bit of chemo. I went through chemotherapy every 21 days for 6 months, 5.5 hours of chemotherapy each time. Leaking spinal fluid was harder than my chemotherapy. And chemotherapy does a lot of different things to different people, but it's very weakening, and it becomes difficult to walk across a room after chemo, not for an hour or two, but for more like, you know, you have about 2 weeks of it, and as soon as you begin to feel like maybe you're getting another one or two red blood cells, you have to do it again. But leaking is harder. Leaking is harder. It's more mentally taxing. It is just the not knowing when it will end or if it will end. And it hurts more. It just hurts more. Physically, it's more painful. So it's just such a challenge. It is such a challenge. And the hope factor is so important. The hope factor is so important. And I think that's about all I have to say about it. So thank you.
That was very meaningful. Our next